Testing one, two. Everybody hear me? All right, one little announcement in case anybody hasn't seen it. On the way in, you see that little sword there with the scabbard? There's a story to that which is very interesting, which goes as follows. It was presented to me yesterday by the top guys at West Point Academy. My son, Mark, who is a doctor, but he's also an avid historian in his own right, has had a lot of contacts with West Point. Is this thing working?
Yes.
Is that right? He's had a lot of contacts with West Point over the few years, given a lot of lectures there, and developed a lot of friends. And long story short, Mark said, I'm going to see if I can't convince West Point to set up a lecture series honoring General Wedemeyer, who, of course, was the subject of my book. And so over the past year, there's been emails, conferences going back and forth, and they have finally approved it. The first lecture is going to be sometime next spring. We don't have a date yet, and we don't have a speaker, but West Point's going to take care of that. In any event, it's designed to encourage and spark the young men and women who are in West Point to embark upon a career like General Wedemeyer, a lifelong study of strategy, history, literature, War College, Carlisle Barracks. Wedemeyer died at age 91, and he was a student till the day he died. And that's what it takes to be a strategist. Unfortunately, we don't have any, or many, these days. We certainly could use them with the ragtag militias that are wiping out the most powerful army in the war. So maybe what we're doing here will produce a couple of mini General Wedemeyers. We'll keep you posted. In any event, they gave us my wife was with me, and Mark and his wife also, and they gave us a tour of West Point that you don't normally get to see. We went to places that the average person will not see at West Point. And at the end, they took us into a room, and we said, we have this presented to you. It's an original scabbard and sword that the cadets carry in their annual march. And I was very much impressed with that. Very nice of them to do that. In any event, that's the story about the scabbard. Now, tonight, we have a couple of new people here tonight. Can we have your name and how you heard about us, please, so the audience can hear that? Thank you. Anybody else? All right. We have two here. I'm sorry.
I'm Richard Matula, and I came here through my friend John Connor.
Okay. Thank you. Anybody else?
I've been here before.
All right. Folks, we are truly honored tonight to have William Pat Schuber here as a lecturer. I heard Pat, I guess it was about a year ago, up in Bergen County, and gave a lecture which was the exact mimic duplication of the tour of Sicily and Italy that I took with my two friends, I think it was 2 years in July. And he did a wonderful job. Pat is a graduate of Fordham University with a BA and received his law degree at Fordham University School of Law. And he's currently serving as counsel to the law firm of Decotis, Fitzpatrick & Cole in Teaneck. Pat served as the county executive of Bergen County for 12 years, 9 years as mayor of the New Jersey State Assembly and mayor of the borough of Bogota for 4 years. He's an assistant professor in the School of Administrative Science at Fairleigh Dickinson University, and his courses include leadership, government, homeland security, law, ethics, and communications. He's also the co-director of the Diplomat and International Relations Program. He's past adjutant professor in business law at Montclair University. I guess that's Montclair State, isn't it?
Yes. Yeah.
and Seton Hall University. He is also an instructor in the Certified Public Manager Course of Studies and the Police Executive Leadership Course sponsored by the New Jersey State Association of Chiefs of Police, and also the New Jersey State Police. He's an honorary member of that group. Pat has conducted leadership staff seminars at many battlefields, including Gettysburg, Antietam, Trenton, Princeton, Monmouth, Brandywine, and Normandy, France. He's lectured frequently on military history, historical leadership, homeland security, ethics, communications, and conflict resolution to numerous civic groups. Pat has written several scholarly articles and co-authored books on topics of history, leadership, and homeland security. He served as a captain in the United States Army Reserve and has been appointed as a commissioner of the Port Authority of New York and New Jersey. And he's going to give us a lecture tonight on Heydrich, Reinhard Heydrich. I've seen the slides. They are amazing. Pat has been to the site, what, three times? Mm-hmm. Three times over the past several years. My pleasure, Pat Schuber.
Yeah, we've got to put it up first.
I got to turn this thing up.
We've got to turn our PowerPoint on here. But let me just, before we, as we're getting started here, I wanted to thank John for the, go ahead, John, put it on. I want to thank John for the kind invitation to be here today and to the World War II Book Club and to talk to you about a topic that's of interest, hopefully, to all of you in special operations. I want to congratulate John on his honor and thank him very, very much. Thank all of you for coming out on what was supposed to be a very difficult night weather-wise. I appreciate all of you coming out. The topic tonight is called A Death in Prague, and it's a focus and an analysis of the assassination of the what would be the highest-ranking Nazi during the Second World War, and that's Reinhard Heydrich, which takes place on May the 27th, 1942, in Prague. And it's a special operation, obviously. The reason I picked the topic was that, in fact, for several reasons, at Fairleigh Dickinson University, where I'm part of the faculty, I have taught a course on World War II, and I've always, when I was teaching that course, I had the raid on Bin Laden that took Bin Laden out had taken place. And one of the questions that arose after we discussed that in class was, would there be any blowback as a result of that? So far, we haven't been able to determine whether there has been or not. But it got me thinking about some of the incidents during the Second World War of special operations in which there was a prime candidate or a prime person taken out as to whether there was any blowback from that. And the first one I looked at was the attack on Admiral Yamamoto that took him out in 1943 in the spring over the Solomon Islands, of which took out a major player for the Japanese and certainly was helpful to the United States and the cause of the American the American military in the Pacific. The second one, however, I looked at was a little more problematical, and that's this one, the operation that took out Reinhard Heydrich. Because although a major player was taken off the board in the Nazi hierarchy, the aftermath of that action raises questions about whether the operation should have been undertaken at all. And it's an ethical question, and I've posed it to my classes on ethics about this. If you were President Beneš, the president of the Czechoslovakia in exile, would you have undertaken the same type of an operation? Or if you had been a citizen of Prague and the local resistance had come to your door and said, would you take one of these parachutists in? What would you have done? What would you have done under those circumstances? So as this plays out tonight, think about that. And think about the courage of these individuals who are no longer with us. Why I find this topic so fascinating is it's like a Greek drama. It's got all the aspects of classical drama. We have a vile, vile villain. We have a courageous set of avengers. And we have a traitorous cur who leads to the unraveling of the whole thing. Everything built into what would be classic Greek drama. And we can now take a look at this and determine how we would have acted as a result of it. So the incident we takes place on May the 27th, 1942. This is a Gestapo photo of Heydrich's car. Let me see if...
The button, turn on button's on the side.
I'm sorry about that.
See
okay.
It?
I got it. Got it.
Let me see. It's on. And there's also a thing there.
You want, okay? Oh, okay, got it.
Okay.
John, it's not moving.
No light coming out now. There was before.
So you're working for the machine. I can work the machine.
I don't think maybe that's it.
Maybe we work from the machine, John.
Why don't we change the light bulbs?
There we go. Yay. Okay. All right.
Okay.
Give me the high side. So if you'd been a citizen of Prague on the morning of September the 27th, 1941, you would have woken to this on the radio from the Czech controlled press. Quote, the Reich's protector of Bohemia and Moravia, Herr Konstantin von Neurath, has had to suggest to the Führer that he be given leave on medical grounds. Under the circumstances, the Führer could not refuse, and he has entrusted SS-Obergruppenführer and General of the Police, Reinhard Heydrich, with the performance of the duties of the Reich Protector of Bohemia and Moravia.
It's working.
Is it working now? Okay.
Let's try it again.
Okay. Yay. Very good. And with that radio announcement, the people of Bohemia and Moravia, a Reich protectorate at that particular time, were introduced to one of the most sinister characters within the upper echelon of the Third Reich, Reinhard Heydrich. Picture who's here in front of you that many of you may have known, and may have recognized. At the same time as that announcement was made, hundreds of miles away in the UK, in central England, two Czech sergeants from the Czech Brigade were being trained as commandos under special operations that had been authorized by the Czech government in exile. 8 months later, on May the 27th, 1942, the paths of these three individuals, Reinhard Heydrich, Joseph Gabček, and Jan Kubisch, would meet in the curve of the road in the suburbs of Prague, leading to all of the actions that will take place thereafter. Now, I've given you in your materials there, as a good professor, I've given you a couple of pictures, a couple of maps to take a look at along the way. The first is the map of what Czechoslovakia will look like in transition during the time of its occupation and its bifurcation. The second picture is a picture of the assassination site as it existed at that time. And you can see the curve in the road that's going to be extremely important to this. The third picture is a much more focused picture of the site as it would have been looking, as it would have looked like in the photographs on that particular afternoon that were taken by the Gestapo later on. The car, the tram, the locations of the different parachutists or commandos. The fourth is the location in central Prague of the eventual hideout or safe house for the commandos, as well as other commandos not necessarily involved in this operation, but also in hiding in Prague, the Church of St. Charles of Charles Borromeo, today known as the Church of the Orthodox Cathedral of St. Cyril and Methodius. This would be where the drama would finally play out June 14th, 1942. And finally, for those of you who are interested in the topic and would like to follow up on this, I gave you a book list, which is not necessarily exhaustive, but has exactly the numbers of some of the really good books that have come out on this, as well as some magazine articles, as well as the only thing I've left off are the films that have been done over the recreation of this, which have taken place over the course of time. And of course, Heydrich has been the subject of several videos himself, one by HBO and one by German television itself. And I recommend that you might want to take a look at them. One of them, by the way, is a special find, if you can go on the internet and find this, and if you've got enough ink in your printer. The Czech Department, Ministry of Defense, has published a report on the Operation Anthropoid, which is very detailed, with a number of pictures and locations if anybody's going to Prague, which I've listed at the very bottom of my book list there. You can find this online. It's in English, and you can download it. It's I warn you, though, put a lot of paper in the printer, because it's about 100 pages in length as that goes, all right? So this is who I am. And who is this man, Reinhard Heydrich? Well, one of his proteges, Walter Schellenberg, an SS protege of both Heydrich and Himmler, described him as follows. He was a tall, impassive figure with a broad, unsuitably high forehead and small, restless eyes, as crafty as an animal's, of uncanny power, and a wide, full-lipped mouth. His hands were slender and rather too long for his body. They made one think of the legs of a spider. Very well put. His splendid figure was marred by the breadth of his hips, a disturbingly feminine effect, which made him appear even more sinister than he ordinarily might have been. His voice was much too high for so large a man, and his speech was nervous and staccato. A very good description by Walter Schellenberg of this individual. By the way, this picture is taken off Time magazine. In which Heydrich was one of the World War II figures who would appear on Time magazine over the course of that time. We know what we know about him is he's born in Halle, Germany, near Dresden, on March the 7th, 1904. He's one of four children. He's very athletic. His mother and father are very musically inclined. His mother plays the piano. His father owns and runs a music academy in in Halle. He learns to play the violin, which seems to be somewhat out of character here, but he does. Very athletic, and he will continue that athletic challenge all the way through his SS career. In 1919, he's too young for World War I, but he joins the Freikorps in the aftermath of the First World War in 1919, and depending on who you listen to, gets involved in a couple of fisticuffs with regard to that. But he's somewhat restless, looking for a career. And the one that comes to mind because of some friends of his family is joining the Naval Academy at Kiel, which he does in 1922. He graduates in 1926 as a lieutenant, serves on a series of ships as a communications officer. There's some belief that he might have had some signals intelligence work that he did, but it's not quite clear because his whole record is pretty much clamped upon when he comes to power. However, he is also has a wandering eye. And although he had been betrothed to Lena von Osten, the young lady at the bottom of the slide, he had been dismissed from the Navy under a cloud as a result of a hearing under court-martial on April the 30th, 1931, for breaking a promise to another woman who he had had an affair with, whose father was very, very friendly with Admiral Rader, who was in charge of the Naval Academy at that particular time in the German Navy during the post Versailles period of time. So he leaves under a cloud, and it almost cost him his marriage. But he's able to put that back together again. Lena stays with him. Lena, by the way, and her family are already very much ardent Nazis. Heydrich is not. They will introduce him to the concept of it, although he's very familiar with it. But he's now looking for a career. Here we have a picture of him as a young Navy lieutenant here, very tall, thin, as you can see. Here, the wedding picture of the bride, Lena von Osten there on the left, Heydrich there on the right. And through family friends of his wife, he gets a contact with Heinrich Himmler. And he gets the chance to go to Munich to meet Himmler at his chicken farm, by the way, which today, by the way, if you were to visit, is a fast food restaurant. I don't know if there's anything to that, but the fact of the matter is that's where it was. And Himmler is impressed by him. And he's asked there for the purpose of creating an intelligence service for the party, which will later be known as the SD, the Sicherheitsdienst. And he will join the party in June of 1931, and then he joins the SS in July of 31, establishing the party's intelligence service, the SD. Now, initially, the SD will be a party intelligence service for the purpose of examining the party members for traitors, among others. But afterwards, it will become much more sinister as the organization, which will be, along with the Gestapo, will visit terror upon all of the occupied countries of Europe in the aftermath of the coming to power of the Third Reich. And in 19, he rises through the establishment as Himmler's deputy, as Himmler's right-hand man for many cases, not his deputy, so to speak, but he is his right-hand man, and Himmler comes to rely on him to a great extent, and he joins all of the security services under one main heading in 1939, in September of 1939, known as the Reich Main Security Office, or the RSHA, the Reich Sicherheitshauptamt, which includes the Gestapo. Here's a picture. One of the things we know about Heydrich is he is a dogged worker. He's a very good organizer and a very good detail man and administrator, and he works like a dog on whatever he's assigned to do. This picture really probably encapsulates that to a great extent. This picture is taken in Munich, by the way. Oh, there it is. One of the things he pioneers, by the way, this letter's hard to read, but it's from Heydrich, and basically what he pioneers for Hitler is what's called the Meldungen aus dem Reich. It's a weekly report put together by the SS and by the SD and the Gestapo for Hitler's eyes and other party leaders. And it gives a good example of what people are talking about throughout the Reich. Surprisingly, when you read it today, and I have a couple of copies of this, it's quite accurate as to what it reports. It's not exactly what Goebbels will report in the Volkischer Beobachter, but it is very accurate as to public pulse that the SD is checking upon during the course of the time. Heydrich masterminds this, and this report would be given on a regular basis. But what we also know about Heydrich is that over the course of time, as a result of the radicalization of the regime and the coming to fruition of a final solution of what they call the Jewish question, Heydrich will be given the authority to put the administrative apparatus together for that purpose. And he'll call a meeting which will eventually be held on January the 20th, 1942 at Wannsee, known as the Wannsee Conference. It's the only one that which we have a record of, and that only very sparingly through some minutes, which is the secretary of which will be this sinister character on the right, Adolf Eichmann, head of the Jewish office within the RSHA. There's the Wannsee mansion right now. That's the way it looks today. I know some of you guys are going to visit. This is what you're going to see when you get there. And there they put together the final, or they really put the imprimatur on already something that's already underway, and that is the apparatus for the eradication of the Jewish people of occupied Europe, which will be his signature event as he moves on off. This takes place, by the way, when he's already in Prague. He'll come back and forth. When Heydrich is appointed the Reichsprotector of Bohemia and Moravia, he doesn't give up any other posts. He keeps everything else. So he's keeping all of these positions to himself as he goes along. So what about Czechoslovakia, this country upon which he is going to visit this terror? Well, we know from our history very briefly that Czechoslovakia did not exist until after the Versailles Treaty is signed. President Wilson is a very big supporter of the Czech concept of independence, the Czech-Slovak idea of independence. Tomáš Masaryk has been able to very masterly work the Allied leaders for this purpose. To make a long story short, October 28, 1918, the new nation of Czechoslovakia is created by the Versailles Treaty. However, by 1939, Hitler, who has come to power, now has looked into Central Europe for the purpose of moving ahead on his plans with regard to the Greater German Reich. Austria will have been annexed in March, and his next target is going to be Czechoslovakia. As a result of the Munich Conference, without going through, we could use a separate talk on that, Czechoslovakia will be, the Sudetenland will be pulled, peeled away from Czechoslovakia without Czech affirmation or even presentation or agreement, given over and then annexed by the Germans. Slovakia will be given autonomy as a result of this, creating now the Czechoslovak Republic, so to speak, at that particular time. And on March the 15th, 1939, the fictitious aspect of this, or the fictitious aspect of Hitler's plans, really come to fruition with the occupation of the rest of Czechoslovakia, Slovakia becoming an independent entity and an ally or a satellite of the Germans and the Axis powers, and the remaining or the rump aspect of Czech Republic being the concept of Bohemia and Moravia, and it becomes a protectorate of the German Reich. It's not incorporated into the Reich, but it becomes a protectorate for which it needs a Reich governor. That governor will be the Reich protector, and the first governor Hitler will appoint is going to be Konstantin von Neurath, an old Prussian, an ambassador to a number of European countries, an old German, so to speak, former foreign minister in the early days of Hitler's regime, coming only to become a Nazi in 1937. And Hitler appoints him thinking he might be acceptable to the rest of Europe as that, as somewhat of a benign figure. So he becomes the first Reich protector. This, of course, the picture here, the famous wartime picture of the Hradčany castle complex, where the governing administration of Czechoslovakia would be and the ancient kings would be. The Germans marching through what's called the Matthias Gate. Here's the picture only a couple of years ago with tourists now pouring through the Matthias Gate. What's very ironical about this picture is that when Heydrich dies, his casket is going to be placed behind that in the courtyard there, which is where he's going to come, where he originally will have come to take the oath of, as the new Reich protector in September. Now, the protectorate government consists of three individuals at that particular time. Neurath over there on the left, the sinister character in the middle, Karl Hermann Frank, a Sudeten German bookbinder who has been the nemesis of Konrad Heinlein, the original Sudeten German leader, and is a member of the SS and will be the state secretary of this new rump Bohemia and Moravia under von Neurath. He will have the ear of Heydrich and Himmler. And here on the right is the puppet leader of the Czech rump government, Emil Hácha. Hácha is a, by this time he's an octogenarian. He is a former, he's a lawyer and a former judge, and what we would consider a Supreme Court judge in the Czech, in the old Czech government. The original president, the second president, Beneš, has fled the country before the Germans have arrived. And is now in exile in England at this particular time, forming a government in exile. In the early stages of this occupation, when von Neurath is still the Reich protector, however, there's a modicum of autonomy to this rump government, only a modicum. There's a terror instrument in the background, and that's controlled by Frank. But there is surreptitious communication between Hácha and his government and Beneš and his government in London, working back and forth on the establishment of a relatively strong underground resistance movement that takes into account large parts of the institutionalized parts of the population, the athletic groups, the military, and things like that. Not under, without the coming under the gaze of the Gestapo, but being kind of constrained by von Neurath, who wants to keep things quiet or keep stable. Now, why is that? Why is this country, or what's left of it, so important to the Germans? The Skoda gunworks and the industrial complex of what remains of the Czech Republic is very important to the German war effort. The Skoda Gun Works is going to produce massive numbers of tanks and guns for the German war effort almost all the way to the end of the war, as well as other complexes between Prague, Pilsen, among other places in there. So this is important to the Germans and their war effort. Plus, it's a very fertile farm area. However, Frank and the SS will actively work to undermine von Neurath's administration. There will be a series of kind of little uprisings around, from students to the press to others, which will eventually lead to Frank producing a dossier for Hitler that will undermine von Neurath's position. And Frank thinks he's going to be the new Reich protector, only to find out that he's been trumped by the people he's been talking to all along, Reinhard Heydrich and Heinrich Himmler. Heydrich now is looking to expand his power base and has now been given the authority by Hitler, with, by the way, Martin Bormann's support. Bormann's here is very canny. He's trying to split Heydrich away from Himmler. Thinks he could send him off to Prague and maybe that will be the end of this kind of a relationship. It won't be. But Bormann helps him get the position. And now on September the 27th, in accordance with the announcement that I just read to you, Reinhard Heydrich now becomes the new Reich protector, or acting Reich protector, or governor of the rump state of Bohemia and Moravia. He will come to Prague on the 27th from Hitler's headquarters in Rostenburg and will, in full military panoply, take a salute here in the courtyard of the Radkani Castle, here where they do the changing of the guard every day today, with Karl Hermann Frank on his right, and pledging a new regime that will make sure that Bohemia and Moravia stay loyal to the Führer and to the Reich. And how he does that will be that immediately upon taking power in Prague, in the castle, where he starts to live, bringing his family with him, he will impose martial law immediately with a curfew. He will execute 400 prisoners immediately and execute a wide array of terror throughout the protectorate, showing the might of the SS right off the bat and the terror to the workers. What he does thereafter, however, is kind of fascinating. He then offers the workers a pension system, and he increases the arms workers' food rations, and he uses a couple of scapegoats of the black market to be executed, which nobody liked to begin with, trying to build up support for the people of the area, but also indicating to them, if you support us or you work, don't work against us, you will be rewarded. However, should you not, this is what happens to those who don't, those who are all who are executed. And this is what you would have seen, these blood red signs that would have come up all the way around town when anybody was executed. This is what you would see. These are actually from the museum in Prague. These would be posted all over. They were blood red, and you could not miss them, listing every person who had been arrested and executed for violations of Reich security. But in London, there was an alternative government, as we've indicated, headed by former President Eduard Beneš, who had been the second president of the Czech Republic after Masaryk, and had been a disciple of Masaryk. But when the Munich Conference had betrayed the Sudetenland, Beneš knew that his role as president was no longer viable, and the Germans were calling the tune, and he fled, first to the United States, and then finally coming back to England. But with him, however, later on, coming out of Prague, however, is another interesting character who will play a role here. That's the man on the far left over there, František Moravec, head of Czech intelligence. Moravec has had a relationship with the intelligence services of Poland, France, and England. And he's been providing information to them as best he can about German war plans. We'll talk a little bit about how he gets that intelligence in a minute. But what he's been able to do is establish a relationship with British intelligence, SIS. And he gets word from his contacts that the Germans are going to march in on March the 15th. And on March the 13th, the British send a KLM plane, thank God it wasn't a United jet, to Prague, and under cover of darkness, the KLM jet will fly Frantisek and his whole staff and the entire intelligence files of the Czech military to London, depriving the Nazis of them. He had been on their watch list, but he would have been imprisoned and executed if he had stayed. Together, they form the nucleus of the government in exile. And in order to understand how this plot comes about, it's important to understand the politics of the governments in exile. The favored government at the moment in exile in London were the Poles, who had been initially supported by Britain and France, and for the reason for which the war had started for them. Second would have been France, with its problematical military leader, Charles de Gaulle. The Czechs were way down the pecking order. Initially, the British only recognized Beneš's Council of Ministers as representative of the Czech people. That meant nothing in the politics of exiled governments. There was no diplomatic relationship between Britain and this group other than recognition. And the big thing was the British did not vocalize or agree to any post-war settlement which would have undone the Munich Accords, which are going to be the important aspect of what Beneš wants, that sooner or later he believes the West will win. And when that happens, he wants Czechoslovakia reinstated as it was prior to Munich. And that's going to be extremely important here as to why the Heydrich operation takes place. A Czech army is created in England from all of the Czech soldiers who have fled Czechoslovakia over the years, through Poland to France, fighting for the French, by the way, who originally don't accept them, send them to the French Foreign Legion, eventually fighting the Germans. Almost not evacuated, except for British intelligence, which insists that the Navy cut a couple of ships free to bring them over, which they do. And they bring them to England, creating a new Czech brigade in England, along with other exiled government brigades. This one housed, the main one housed in central England, reviewed here by Churchill. General Inger, their commander-in-chief there on his left. At the same time, another organization that's going to have a role here, Churchill creates his own organization to create unrest in the occupied territories. Britain standing alone needs some house to provide for problems in the rear areas of the Germans, creates the Special Operations Executive, the SOE, on July the 22nd, 1942, with the slogan of Set Europe Ablaze. It will be responsible for dropping agents into occupied areas for the purpose of aiding resistance, gaining intelligence, providing potentially supplies to resistance movement, and you could write a whole book just on, in fact there are, just on the SOE. But the SOE will work very closely with František Moravec and the Czech intelligence on the Anthropoid operation. Now, one of the key things that Beneš is arguing with Allied leaders about is, I have very valuable intelligence sources that I can continue to provide for you if you will support us. And that key agent is one who they don't know the name of. His name is Paul Fummel. He goes by the code name of Agent 54. He's an Abwehr colonel, working first in Dresden and then finally in Prague. Now Fummel, no one really knows what Fummel's, to this day we don't know what Fummel's motivation here is. He contacts Czech intelligence in 1937 and offers them some intelligence about German plans in the early stage, well before the occupation of Czechoslovakia. Initially, the Czech intelligence think he's a plant, but the information turns out to be relatively good. And so they bring him on as one of their agents. Some people today have argued he did it for money because he gets paid for this. Others said he was disappointed, he was disenchanted with the Hitler regime. It's possible, and it may have been both. The fact of the matter is he's a Gold Party badge member of the National Socialist Party. He's an old fighter, an alter Kämpfer, and he's decided to sell intelligence to the Czechs. And Agent 54 will be the source of what we would call, what Churchill will call, golden eggs, the concept of this great intelligence, and his intelligence is very good. He also gives intelligence on the German operation for Operation Barbarossa, among other things. And Fummel will play an important element here. However, in 1942, he will be betrayed, like many of them, captured by the SD under Heydrich, and he will be tortured. Eventually, he will be imprisoned in the Czech prison at Terezin, near Theresienstadt, the German concentration camp for the elderly. And he will be executed on March the 27th, 1945, within days of the Allied liberation. In April of 1941, in addition to providing for intelligence from Thummel and from other actions of the Czech underground, the Czech government in exile decides to impanel a series of commandos, specially trained, to be dropped into the former Czechoslovakia to do a number of different things. One, bring new radios for the underground so that communication can still be kept. Two, provide for support for the underground for somewhat small acts of terror or sabotage. Three, to gather intelligence. And so in April of 1941, going into the Czech brigade encampments are a series of representatives of the Czech government looking for volunteers who may be willing to do something that's very dangerous, but potentially worthwhile to the cause. And a series of mainly sergeants and lieutenants will be gathered up and specially trained primarily for parachute drops, radio communications, among other things. One of those groups that's going to be very important to us is a group that each of them has a code name, by the way. This group is going to be called Silver A. They're going to play a major role here. Commanded by Lieutenant Alfred Bartos and a second Sergeant Joseph Valchek. Now, Valchek is a Czech sergeant. Bartos is from Slovakia. They are responsible for dropping into old Czech Republic with new radios and to make contact with the agents who are running Paul Fummel, because Heydrich's reign of terror has arrested huge numbers of the underground and has destroyed numerous of the radios. And so it's extremely important for these operations to be successful. Now keep an eye on Valchek, because he's going to be play a role in Anthropoid. But with Heydrich's reign of terror and the running up together of all of the agents and the arrest of the numbers of agents, the execution of many, the capture of numerous radios, all of a sudden this intelligence source out of Prague is drying up. And remember, this is an important act. This is important currency for Prague and Benes for the purpose of the post-war settlement of Czech borders. And so it becomes clear to Benes, we don't know when, but at least we believe starting in October of 1941, that something drastic has to be done in Czechoslovakia if the government is going to be able to sustain itself and the resistance is going to be able to sustain itself, and in the aftermath of the war, the Czech Republic will be reconstituted. So somewhere, we don't have the documents, they make a decision to train a special group of commandos, two, for the purpose of dropping them in to assassinate one of two characters, either Karl Hermann Frank or Reinhard Heydrich himself. When they discuss it, it becomes clear that killing Frank would make no difference, because not too many people out of Czechoslovakia knew who the hell he was. But Heydrich's a different character now. He's a high-ranking Nazi with great ambition and relatively well-known, and it's his terror that's being imposed on the Czech people. They choose two young men, one from Slovakia, one from Czechoslovakia. Initially, Sergeant Josef Gabček, a locksmith, in his 20s, highly well-trained, with a good report from the British overseers. His initial partner is going to be Lieutenant Svoboda, who injures himself in a parachute drop, and he's replaced by Gabček's friend, Sergeant Jan Kubisch, a Czech a Czech peasant farmer who's become a military man and is an explosive expert. They will be trained specially outside of the vein of the other agents who are being dropped in with a special assignment they only know. The assassination by the end of the year, the target is now moved directly onto Heydrich with SOE support. Now, the Czech wartime intelligence headquarters is a building you can find today in London. It's on the porch, it's called the Porchester Gate. It's on the Bayswater Road coming into London from the west. And the gate, the building is still there, and surprisingly, it's a condominium today. When I first went there, and after having looked up the address and finally finding the building, I went there, the concierge had no idea what I was talking about. But he said, look, I come inside and look, and I looked in and there was this wall, just like the ones from the background of the picture, like that one right there. And then he showed me a World War II underground bomb shelter that was still in existence that they had down below. When I came back, they now had pictures of the famous photographs. Before they are dropped in, they dropped into intelligence headquarters, took a pledge to this special operation, and had their pictures taken. These are the pictures, and that's the location of where the pictures were taken. And in fact, this is the building itself as it existed today. This was the headquarters of Czech intelligence, and this is the British monument to, you'll find these all over Europe, all over England now for the purpose of commemorating these commandos, by the way. This one's on that particular building. Now they're going to be dropped at the end of December over Prague in a British Halifax bomber. They can only do it in December when the nights are relatively brief, and the coverage by clouds for German fighters would be difficult for them. And so on December the 28th, piling into the Halifax bomber would be these two commandos, Lieutenant Sergeant Gabchek, Sergeant Kubisch, along with Silver A and Silver B, another communications commando operation. Altogether, eight commandos in the Halifax bomber to be dropped at different locations over Czech Republic. They are dropped. None of them drop in the area they're supposed to be dropped. They're dropped miles away from their location. To make a long story short, they're able to find themselves back with help from other resistance members who luckily find them. And Gabchek and Kubisch will be brought into Prague, and they will be then shunted from safe house to safe house to safe house. One of those safe houses, which will be important to us, is the house of Maria Moravec and her husband, who's a railway man, and her son, Atta. They will come there first and then be shunted around to a series of other homes, which will be important. Imagine that now. You're under Heydrich's terror, and you're being asked to hide a couple of Czech parachutists. You know, what would you have done under those particular circumstances? The bravery of these people is unbelievable through the operations they do. Coming after them, however, is this operation, Outdistance, another one of these parachute drops for communication purposes, commanded by Lieutenant Adolf Opalka, and with this individual, who we're going to pay attention to very shortly, Sergeant Carol Curta, who will be also dropped in. Their purpose is to increase the communication operations throughout occupied Bohemia and Moravia. None of them are supposed to know about Gabchek and Kubisch's operation. But as we're going to see, these people, these trainees, they gossip. And it's becoming clear quite very quickly that there's something special about Gabchek and Kubisch, why they're there. And people are starting to put two and two together. Now, here's some of the safe houses today. This is the Fafik family, one of the places where the commando stayed initially and then will stay after the attack. Each of these houses, because all of these people meet a horrible fate, each one of those commemorated with a commemorative sign today, usually with a little bit of flower that's left there over the course of time. Again, you can only imagine the courage of these people and the terror they experienced thereafter. So, what are we going to do here? How are we going to do this operation? Well, with Kubik, Kubis, and Gabcek are a MK, a Sten gun, a British Sten gun, a collapsible weapon into three parts, a Sten gun operation, a Sten gun Mark II, which is going to be the assassination weapon. Behind that, however, are two anti-tank grenades, specially fitted with contact fuses. They're supposed to explode on contact with whatever they meet. And that's what they've been given to train with and to use. Initially, they want to hit him while he's in his car, but he's living in the castle. And the castle is heavily guarded, and they can't get close to him. They attempt to try to blow up his train, because he has his own train when he goes back and forth to Berlin to report to Hitler. But that is moving too quickly. They can't find a way to do it. They think about maybe attacking. Eventually, he moves from his castle to a mansion out in the suburbs called Penensky Brzezani. We'll see it in a minute. They think about attacking that, but it's heavily guarded by the SS. So they put that off their trail. They check the road from the new mansion into Prague. And they think maybe it's rural enough they can attack him there, but he happens to like speed. And he speeds along the roadway too quickly. Plus, it's too open. They'll never escape. So they decide to look closer to Prague. There's a road, it's on your map, that when he comes into the middle of town to take the road to the castle, the road bends. And he's got to slow down. And they choose that location to make the assassination attempt. By the way, this is where he lived initially in the Radkani Castle. This is the Cernan Palace. This over here is what is the entrance to his mansion in the suburbs of Prague, Penensky Brzezani. Today it's a total dilapidated building owned by private enterprise. The reason you know it's got those two monuments on either side. Those are boars. B-O-A-R, boars, covered in garbage bags today. The government originally used it for the Ministry of Defense. Today, it's used as a business incubator. I told John at dinner, Heydrich's son, one of his sons, is still alive. He's in his late 70s. And 2 or 3 years ago, he offered to pay to rebuild that, to reestablish the mansion. And the Czech people and the newspapers rose up, and he had to withdraw the money. It's from that door that he will leave on the morning of the 27th on his fateful journey with the commandos further 12 miles down the road. This is what the villa would really look like. This is Karl Hermann Franck's villa. It's three doors down the road. You can see how elaborate it would have been at the course of the time. His is an exact copy of it, except it's much more dilapidated than this one. This is where the Nazi elite lived, in the suburbs. These were all owned by Jewish businessmen before the war, who had been deported by this particular time. Prior, however, to the incident, Himmler visits in April, and he's appalled by Heydrich's lack of security. He orders Heydrich to armor his vehicle. He travels around in an open 320 Mercedes convertible, with the top down, with one sergeant driving him, and no escort. He orders him to armor the vehicle and to take an escort wherever he goes. After Himmler leaves, Heydrich does none of these things. He fails to armor the vehicle, he orders no escort, and it's the arrogance of Heydrich. Heydrich will say, no one is going to attack me, I represent the Reich, they would be too afraid to do so. Famous last words. On the night of the 26th, in what is one of these garish German celebrations, known as the Week of German Music for the Czech people, celebrating his father's compositions on the night of the 26th, he appears with his wife, who is pregnant with their fourth child, at a concert in celebration of his father's music. He goes home that day, and on the morning of the 27th, arises early. But instead of going to his car, as he normally did, he plays with his children in the yard while the car idles in the front of the mansion itself. Now he's got four. He will have four children eventually, two boys, two girls. Right now he's got two boys and a girl. His wife is pregnant with another girl. The location, Here's the location from the Gestapo photos. You can see it on your map. Notice he's going to come down from the top left of the photo, coming down. He's going to have to slow because that curve in the road is very sharp. And coming up the other way is a tram line. And this gives cover to the commandos because they can sit there looking like they're getting on the tram for relatively good periods of time and not be questioned. All right? That's why it appeals to them. This is what it looks like today when I was there the last time. It's changed a little bit, but the curve is still there, and you can get a sense for it. And this area has gotten very busy, by the way. Here's another looking at it from up on top, and you've got a kind of a picture of this. It's going to come from the left, coming down the road here, and the attack will take place right in here. All right? This road up here is going to be important because one of the commandos is going to escape down this road with the German sergeant chasing him right down the road here. So, the weapons to be used, the Sten gun, the anti-tank grenade, looking like it's taped actually, with a contact fuse on it. Kubisch has two of these in a brown satchel case. The Sten gun is divided into three parts in another satchel case. They've arrived on the location on bicycles. And they have a raincoat to cover the Sten gun. And they're dressed in suits like they're commuters. There are two other members with them this time because they've expanded their team. Lieutenant Opalka from outdistance has now joined them as a lookout. He's across the street with another bicycle. Up the road is Sergeant Valchek from the Silver A team. His picture is now known to the Gestapo and he's in hiding. And the commandos who knew him already have incorporated him into their team, although they were not supposed to. He's standing up the roadway with a mirror. He's supposed to signal them when the car is at the top of the roadway so they can be prepared. And by the way, this is one of the original weapons, by the way. The grenade is not. This is in the Prague Military Museum in Prague. This is Heydrich's car. This is the Mercedes 320 open convertible. Now, there's an interesting irony here. When the Germans occupied Bohemian Moravia, they required German language signs to be used everywhere, and they demand that the driving privileges go the opposite way than they had been, like in the UK. In the UK, you know, you drive on the other side of the road. Well, the Czechs did too. But now they're going to drive on the other side of the road like the Germans. That's going to put Heydrich closer to the assassin than he might ordinarily have been if they had left well enough alone. This car has been recently refurbished by Mercedes-Benz, by the way, and is now, I believe, on display in the Czech Military Museum. I have not seen it yet, but this is a picture of that as I found it. Now the attack itself, this is the recreation that takes place every year, by the way. Here's the location, and so here's what happens. Gabchek, Kubisch is standing here. Gabchek is standing here. Valchek is over here. Opalka is over here. And they've arrived at 9 o'clock, 9:15. Heydrich is expected at approximately 9:30, like he had been in clockwork all the time. And 9:30 comes and goes, and he's not shown up yet. And they're standing around. Trams have come and gone. And they're starting to get nervous now that someone's going to question them of why they're standing there. And why? Heydrich is taken for this time because he's going to fly to Berlin that night. It's one of the reasons the attack takes place on this day. They've gotten word that he's leaving, and maybe for good, to take on another assignment. So it becomes urgent for them to do this. As a result of which, he spends more time with his family that morning, playing with the children, with Sergeant Johannes Oberscharfuhrer Johannes Klein idling in the driver's seat, waiting for him to come out. He finally comes out at 10:15, and they proceed down the road. And at approximately 10:28 or 10:38, Valchek signals him with a mirror. And the car starts to come. It arrives down here and slows down. And as it slows down, Gabchek throws down his raincoat and he steps forward with the Sten gun and he pulls the trigger, pointing it directly at Heydrich, who's looking at him. and nothing happens. The gun misfires. Heydrich, instead of what the Secret Service is supposed to do, which is to drive immediately out of this kill zone, he stands up and demands Klein to stop the vehicle, and he starts pulling out his pistol. As he does that, coming out of the shadows is Jan Kubisch with his contact grenade, and he tosses it like a softball against the vehicle. He's trying to get it inside the vehicle because it's open, but it doesn't get there. Maybe he's too nervous. It hits the right rear side of the vehicle, but it explodes, driving material from it into the back and side of Heydrich. Heydrich stands, though, and gets out of the vehicle, and he starts to come after Kubisch. Klein gets out, and he comes, and he starts to go after Valchek. Kubisch grabs his bicycle and takes off. Valchek over here grabs his bicycle. He takes off. Opalka grabs his bicycle. He takes off. Heydrich, we are told, is somewhere in this area, collapses on the ground. And he yells out, "Get that bastard," which is the only guy left standing there is Gabchek here with his inadequate Sten gun. He throws it to the ground and he takes off up this road and then down that side road that I showed you on that other map, with Klein chasing him down the roadway. That road, by the way, today is known as Gabchek Street. And we'll see what happens in a minute. These are the Gestapo photos of the crime scene. You can see the damage to the rear of the vehicle. You can see the vehicle here from the other side. This is the Gestapo photo from the rear. This is the... They will all be in safe houses. And this is one of those safe houses. This is Mrs. Moravec's house. They'll be staying right here. They left, however, this bicycle, as well as their satchel cases. And the Gestapo will put them in the window of the major shoe shop with a reward notice. Heydrich will be placed in the back of a truck full of polish, and it will be shipped over to the hospital, which is nearby, Bulkova Hospital, where he will be examined by doctors. And he refuses to be examined by Czech doctors. Initially, they think the wound is superficial, but when they do an x-ray, they find out it's much more serious than it was. He's got a broken rib, and debris has been pushed into the wound itself, and it's much more serious, so an operation is necessary. His spleen is in danger. And so they get a German doctor to come down that he's acceptable to. I can imagine they're arguing over this. And they start the operation, and they put him to bed for the night under the understanding that he will get better, and he won't. Immediately, however, Hitler demands 10,000 Czechs to be executed. And Karl Hermann Frank, instead of arguing with Hitler, not a good idea to do, he flies to Rostenburg. And he makes his case and says, "Look, let us find these people. We think it's the British who did this. It's their guns we found. And let us do this. We don't want to disrupt operations or the economy. But we'll make symbolic executions," which they will do, by the way. And let us see if we can find them. Over the next 2.5 weeks, they find nobody. It's the biggest manhunt in European history until the 9/11 attack. The Germans will leave no stone unturned. They will literally check everyone's house and apartment and car, to the extent they had a vehicle. In fact, they almost catch two of them who are hidden in walls. They immediately order the Sippenhof punishment. If you harbor them, you will be killed, and all of your family will be killed on top of that. And they offer a million marks reward. The Czech government, the puppet government, offers another million marks. And these are the signs that go up for this, but these are the summary execution, the blood red that'll take place. 400 people executed immediately. All of the Czech military that is behind bars, all the former underground agents captured, all of them will be shot immediately in the aftermath of the attack. And the biggest manhunt ensues. Who's responsible for that? Well, these people. On the left, one of the biggest thugs within the SD operation, even the SD thinks he's a thug. And that's Karst Böhme on the left-hand side, commander of the SD in Prague. Karl Harman Frank, now act as head of the Gestapo in Prague. And the successor to Heydrich, Kurt Deloygi, here, once Heydrich's adversary within the SS hierarchy, head of the Kripo, the criminal police, now head acting Reich protector, which he will maintain till the very end of the war almost. Frank, again, disappointed in failing to gain that. However, they will be responsible now for the manhunt that's taking place to find the agents. Now, this picture was taken in Gestapo headquarters. This lady is one of the survivors. She's a docent in the museum. The museum today is in the Ministry of Education. It's the original Gestapo headquarters, the headquarters for the manhunt. And these would be the signs that would have been put up all over with regard to the attempt to capture. She survived. She's a student at the time. She's arrested, tortured, but is not executed and survives the war, with harrowing tales, by the way. Again, this is what would have appeared in Czech papers, the reward that's offered. And on the 4th of June, surprisingly to his doctors, although by the end it was quite clear he was not going to survive, Heydrich will develop septicemia. They do not have penicillin at that particular time in Germany. They have sulfonamides, but it's not sufficient. And he dies of the infection on the morning of the 4th of June, 7:30 a.m. at this hospital, Bukova, which still exists today and looks the same as it did the day he was brought there. It begins a series of very, very garish Nordic ceremonies. First with his being laid out at the Matthias Gate under the SS ruins on the 5th of June, 1942. His body will then be taken by caisson to the train station, shipped to Berlin, in which there will be a huge ceremony on June the 9th, with Hitler and Himmler speaking. This is that ceremony now. Those are Heydrich's sons, Klaus and Heider, greeting Hitler and Himmler. Here's a kind of a photo montage of this, with the Czech government having to be present at that particular time, and then being attacked by Hitler afterwards in a private meeting that they have to produce the commandos. They have not yet been found. This is part of the ceremony. Hitler is so overcome with emotion, allegedly, he presents the highest German award that you can to Heydrich's beer, calls him a man with an iron heart. I don't know if that's actually the accolade you want when you're put in the ground, but that's what Heydrich gets. And Heydrich's body is then placed on the caisson, is taken over to the Invaliden Cemetery, a cemetery for military heroes that exists to the present day. A stamp is produced in his honor, and there's the initial tombstone. This is the ceremony. As Churchill said, it was pure German bad taste. This is the Invaliden Cemetery 2 years ago. The Berlin Wall went through the back end of it initially. It was cut off from any type of a tour or ability to access it. I believe that this is the location that Heydrich lays in to this day. There's no record that his body ever was taken from there. It's possible, but it doesn't look likely. There's no record of it, though, by the way. And the only way you can look at it is look at the old photos, match them up with the way they look. And to my ability to believe it, I believe he's buried right in that location, right there. Again, he becomes a martyr to the cause, like Horst Wessel. The stamp is produced. A monument is placed at the site of the assassination, and people who pass it have to give the Hitler salute as they pass by with a guard of honor. When the war ends and the Red Army arrives, the first monument that's crushed is this one. So where are the commandos? What happened to them? Well, they've been pushed from safe house to safe house now. Not only the four of them, but a series of others that are hiding in the same area. And it becomes too hot for them. And so they approach the patriarch of the Greek Orthodox Cathedral. And he agrees to take them into the catacombs of the church. The Carol Borromeski Church, Charles Borromeo today, St. Methodius and Cyril and Methodius. And they place them in the catacombs. This is what it looks like today. This is what it looks like today. It's almost identical, all right? And they hide there for literally a week. And up to this point, the Gestapo has gotten no leads. And then this happens. Lidice. On June the 10th, on the 9th, the town of Lidice is surrounded by the SD and the SS. There is belief that the commandos had come through Lidice. They had not. I believe that the SS is looking for a scapegoat here. And they use a very flimsy evidence to prove that the commandos had been there. They decide to make an example of Lidice. And they surround it over the course of the 10th of June in the morning. This village has 96 houses and a church and a school and almost 500 residents. They take the men and the boys, 15 years of age and older. They bring them to the Horak farm on the premises. The women are taken to the church with their children. And the men are proceeded to be executed in groups of 10 until all of them are dead. The women are sent to the concentration camps, of which only two come back. The children, any of them that could be Germanized under the new German racial system, are going to be given to SS families. Only six of them come back. All the rest of them are gassed at Chelmno. And this is the worst atrocity in the Czech Republic, in Czechoslovakia, as a result of this war. And not only that, the SD poses for pictures at the site itself. As a result of this site, almost like Carthage after the end of the Punic Wars, will be completely destroyed, completely plowed over, the waterway through it will be diverted, and there'll be no signs left that it ever existed. This is what it looks like today. In fact, it's not been rebuilt. It's been rebuilt close by. This is the memorials too on the site of Lidice today. This is the Horak farm. This is where the executions took place. This is the memorial cross. This is the exact location of where the barn was, where they put the mattresses up to shield off the firings, and that's the same location. Lidice. 2 weeks later, on the 24th of June, 1942, Silveray's radio communication is found on this location at the town of Lazaki. Here, this town is 96 people. The Germans surround this. This time, everybody's executed. The town is destroyed to the last. This is the radio transmitter they find. And they destroy it. Today, these monuments represent where those tombs were. This is what the town looked like. And this is the location of where all of the people were taken to be executed. This is the SS barracks at Pardubice, the local regional town. This is the site itself today, the memorial. That is where they were all executed. This is an SS shooting grounds. And it memorializes all of the almost 500 people executed on this location. On the 16th of June, 1942, however, on the 13th of June, a letter arrives in Gestapo headquarters. The letter says, I know, it's not signed. It says, I know who did the assassination. It's Jan Kubisch and Joseph Gabczak, but it's not signed, and the Gestapo pays no attention to it. These are unknown people to them. They have no photos of them. It's sent by Carol Curta, who has escaped from Prague, is living with his mother at this time, and allegedly is shocked by the atrocity at Lidice. On the 16th, he takes the trolley into Prague, and he appears at Gestapo headquarters. He enters in and asks to speak to an officer. He tells them, I know how it happened. They don't believe him. They torture him. And finally, he gives out the information. He says, these are the people who did it. I wrote the letter. I don't know where they are, but I know where they've been. And he gives up all the safe houses in Prague. The Gestapo the next day surround all of them, arresting everybody in all of the different houses, and take them here to the basement of the Gestapo headquarters. These are the original cells. This is what they look like. And these are obviously Gestapo instruments that were taken at the site and now part of the museum there. And the initial home is the Moravec home, where they originally were when they arrived in Prague. Here they are, the Gestapo breaks into the apartment. Mrs. Moravec bites down on a cyanide capsule and drops dead. Her son and her husband are taken to Gestapo headquarters. Under torture, the son says, I don't know where they are, but my mother always said that if I was in trouble, I was to go to the Orthodox Church. On the 17th, the SS surround, on the 18th, the SS, in the morning, late in the 17th, on the morning of the 18th, they surround the Carol Boromeski church. They enter the church, and they look around, they can find nothing. They go through the offices, they have the caretaker with them. They're looking for the bishop. They go through, and all of a sudden, someone drops a grenade on them from the choir loft, and a fight begins. Up on the choir loft are three of the commandos. There are seven commandos in here, four of the original and three others. The four, three are in the choir loft and four are in the catacombs. The three in the choir loft are there because they're trying to get some fresh air. The Gestapo, the SS and the Gestapo, under orders to try to capture them alive, will enter into a gun battle, of which several people will be killed. Shortly thereafter, some shots are heard, and when they arrive at the top of the choir loft, all three commandos are dead, having shot themselves. Up there is Opalka, Lieutenant Opalka, and Jan Kubisch, along with another commando. They bring them out and drag them onto the floor of the church right in this location. And they bring out the traitor, and they ask him to identify them. And he says, well, these are not all of them. There's somebody missing. They go back into the church, and they're starting to look around, and someone gets the bright idea there may be a basement. And so they find a door to the basement, they start to go down, and all of a sudden shots ring out, and two SS men fall dead. And now a two-hour gun battle takes place on the outside with the SS, with the commando still in the basement. This is what it looks like. There's the choir loft today. This is the stairwell that they had to get up there to try to get them. This is the entrance where they finally found into the catacombs in the floor of the cathedral. And they bring the fire department in. There's an air vent here. They pump water into it. This is the way it looks today, by the way. You can still see the bullet holes around it and the monuments on it. They pump water into it, but the water doesn't take. So finally, they start to attack it. They drop grenades. They drop everything into it. Nothing happens, and after 2 hours, they hear four shots. And then finally, they go down, they find all four of the commandos dead by their own last bullet. They bring them all out, they take a victory lap, as only the SS could, and they take up their material. And today, this is what it looks like. Their memorial's all in the location itself. Here's the Gestapo photo of the bodies. This is the monument there at the present time. What happens to the people who were involved here? The church leaders are taken here after a trial and executed. All of them. The bishop. The Greek Orthodox churches throughout the protectorate are closed and their property confiscated. This is a major memorial. By the way, this memorial is literally only a quarter mile from from Heydrich's assassination site. The family members of all of the safe houses, 243 of them, are shunted off to Mauthausen concentration camp, one of the more sinister places in the Nazi pantheon, and they're all executed on the 24th of October 1942. This is the gas chamber in which they're executed. In the aftermath of the attack, 5,000 victims of the Nazi reprisals, 3,000 Jews, all shipped out of Theresienstadt to the east, and we know what that means. None of them return, as well as all of the leaders of the Czech underground. The Czech underground will be decimated. It will never reconstitute itself until the Red Army is banging on the doorway in 1945. However, Britain renounces the Munich Agreement, just what Benesch wanted, and enters into full diplomatic relations with the Czech government in exile. Benesch will never admit that he ordered the attack and will never speak about it ever again. The Czech government in exile achieves its enhanced status. But Lidice becomes a major propaganda victory for the Allies. And it's played up, and maybe you can remember reading this or seeing this. Lidice shall live. Towns in America and throughout the world are named Lidice. Several towns still in America today, in Illinois among others, named Lidice. How does Prague remember the attack? Well, in the aftermath of the war, they didn't. Why? Because the Russians didn't do it, nor did they authorize it. It was a British-Czech operation for Czechs who were not involved with the communists or the Soviets, as a result of which there were very little monuments. Today, however, with the wall falling, these monuments are all. This is on the execution site. It's a very bizarre monument, by the way. This is a tall monument at the executions, at the assassination site at the curve in the road. These now are the bust monuments in the cathedral catacomb for each of the seven. What happens to the people who were involved here? Carl Hermann Frank is captured by the Americans, given over to the German, to the Czechs, tried and executed in Pankrac prison. How about Carl Curta, the traitor, captured by the Americans, given over? By the way, after he does this, he continues to be a Gestapo informer, making almost a million marks until the end of the war, marrying an SS officer's wife. He will be tried and executed by the Czech government. Kurt DeLoigi will be also tried and executed. Heydrich's successor and the SD, Ernst Kaltenbrunner, will be tried and executed in the Nuremberg trials. So I dedicate my presentation to the bravery of these three men, among others, and the courage that they showed. And remember the commandos and what they did and how they did it, and the courage they showed when I think they knew this was an operation from which they might not have come back alive, and they did not. And we also remember Lidicek. This is one of the most enduring monuments I've ever seen. This is to all the children of Lidicek. This monument is right, very prominently displayed there. As we know, only a few of the children ever came back. All the rest disappeared into the concentration camps in the East, probably all murdered as a result of this. The end. But before they close, John, can we maybe get the lights on?
Yeah.
Just let me take a slug of water here for a minute. I got it. First of all, thank you for listening to me. I hope I didn't take too long, and I was trying to keep it within the time period that John had given me before we get thrown out of the library tonight. But I'd be glad to take your questions. Yes, sir.
You mentioned that as a result of the assassination, that the leadership of the Greek Orthodox Church was finally executed.
Yeah.
What's the status of the Greek Orthodox Church, say, in 1960 and even today in Czechoslovakia?
It's reinstated. Okay. This is a church again. By the way, it's a museum in the basement. You can go there just to see the museum, but the church is active again.
As a Greek Orthodox?
Yes, it is. Yeah. as churches have been activated throughout the Czech and the Slovak Republic. Yeah. Yes?
The monument you showed was at the site with the, just right near the end, you showed the people on top.
Yeah. It's a relatively new monument, by the way.
Okay.
It was put up only a couple of years ago.
Okay.
It was put up a couple of years ago on the site of the assassination. It sits just a little bit over from it.
Okay.
You cannot miss it, believe me when I tell you. It's huge. Yeah.
But it was just up a couple of years ago.
Yeah, only a couple of years ago. It's only in the last couple of years that the Czechs have embraced this. You can understand it. I mean, they accepted the bravery of these men and what they did. It was the highest ranking Nazi assassinated throughout the war by a resistance group anywhere. Other Nazis will be assassinated, but nobody as high up in the hierarchy as Heydrich. The moral question is, was it worth it or not, given all of the reprisals that took place thereafter and the decimation of the Czech underground, which it really was. Beneš gets his political objective accomplished, but, and by the way, the other objective he wants is the German citizens who lived in the Sudetenland to be expelled at the end of the war, and they are. So the dual purpose of this he gets as a result of that. I should add one last tragedy, well, somewhat of a tragedy. Heydrich's older son, Klaus, will be killed in an automobile accident a year after his father's death. He'll come out of that gate, running out of that gate, maybe playing a game, and runs into the middle of the road. Coming up the road is a truck, and it barrels right into him and kills him. So he dies tragically, and a piece of currency, which you can find in some of the antique shops in Prague, with the son's picture on it is produced by the government, the protectorate. His wife and his kids who remain, plus the new baby who's born thereafter, will become refugees when the Red Army arrives. The anecdotal story here is that Mrs. Heydrich becomes a real pain in the neck, bothering Himmler for every little bill that she's got. Himmler has to make personal visits to keep her calm, and they will trot her out on various memorial days. She and her sons will come back to Germany by way of Bavaria. They will come to the family estate up on the Baltic in a small island called Vermaern. And at Vermaern, they have a hotel which they operate, and she operates until she dies. Gives no interviews thereafter, although she writes a book, I Was the Wife of a War Criminal. She will, though allegedly, gossip will tell me that she will greet with open arms former SS members. She gets a pension from the German government in 1952 because her husband was a German general.
You mentioned that after the tragedy, Churchill repudiated the Munich Agreement?
Correct.
Weren't they at war already? What's the significance
they were.
Of that?
Yes, they were, but they had not verbally agreed to repudiate the Munich Agreement. Remember, the British were actively part of that agreement. And up until that point, politically, they just didn't do it. And that was one of the major goals that Benesch had here, among others, to get them to do formally. The Russians, the Soviets will do it in July of 41. But the British won't do it yet until after Lidice.
I've read that Heydrich was planning to kill the people in the neutral countries. Are you aware of it? You know, any comment?
Well, we don't know what Heydrich's, we know Heydrich's plan for the protectorate would have been eventual extermination or removal of the Slavic citizens of the Bohemia and Moravia. They had already started the racial classifications of those people. The word had gotten out already with regard to that. But he also had greater ambitions. It's believed that he had attempted, that he was leaving that day to meet with Hitler, and he was hoping to be appointed either the occupied Europe head of anti of administration of terror, basically, that he would visit on all occupied territories, what he did in Bohemia and Moravia, or at the very least that he would become the Reich protector, the new Reich protector of France. Where the SS had only had a marginal role to play at that particular time. We don't know completely that. He was going, he had a friend in place there already, Oberg, but we don't know that yet.
The caption on Time magazine said the hangman.
Right.
How did he get that reputation?
Well, because of the butchery that takes place here. The executions would be a number of different ways, hanging, shooting, beheading. The hangman's noose became the symbolic aspect. It was the propaganda used by the British on him as a result of execution or for execution purposes.
Maybe one or two more questions.
Yes, sir, in the back.
Sabotage from the underground happened before his execution, and afterwards, was it stifled?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the whole question.
How much was sabotage took place?
Oh, okay.
Prior to
that's a good
execution,
question.
And how much afterwards? Did it stifle it?
It did. Yes, it did. Until the Red Army was at the gates when there was a rising. However, before that time period, even the Benesch government, recognizing that the Nazis, when challenged internally, would react viciously. There had already been examples of this in other occupied countries. They treaded very lightly on sabotage. What they were attempting to do was light sabotage, maybe a train derailment, maybe some industrial slowdowns, that kind of thing. Not, you know, slowing the war effort down, but not necessarily getting the Germans to overreact. But the British and the Soviets, particularly after Barbarossa, were putting the pressure on Benesch, among others. They're putting the pressure on everybody to ratchet up their actions internally. And so for the Czechs, that meant they were being pushed to act in greater operations of sabotage. And they will undertake one major operation which the British fail miserably. That is the bombing of the Skoda gunworks. all of these men who have been dropped in will become part of this plan in April of 42 to provide beacons for the British bombers to bomb the Skoda gunworks. Because Benesch is saying, hey, look, you want to impinge the German war effort, bomb the Skoda gunworks like you're bombing Germany right now. The British send, I think, 6 bombers. They miss the target. And none of the men are captured, but they are extremely PO'd that they were put out on this type of an operation that failed so miserably and was not supported. And that will be the last act like that, right? There will be small acts thereafter, but nothing like what will happen until the uprisings when the Russians are approaching from the east.
Thank you, Pat.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
Sorry I smiled.